Very good evening and warm and heartfelt Jai Bhim to everybody. I'll try to keep to my time and just begin by locating where this UGC exercise really begins. I think in the last decade, the fact that we have very valuable genealogies of women's studies now available makes our discussion a little simpler. But even then, as we say this, we know that as Dalit Bahujan feminisms are opening up new lines of inquiry, we still are discovering new roots of new roots to women's studies. But for the moment, if we say that this word women's studies was definitely named in 1970s, we know for sure that even today, and I think all the students here who are registered for full-time women's studies programs would bear me out on this, there is tremendous ambiguity of identity that exists on campuses. Students often report that they find themselves either becoming aggressive, defensive, or downright apologetic when they have to introduce themselves as full-time students in women's studies. And probably, I think, as Mary John has argued, the impossibility of the answer or any simple straightforward answer to the question, what do we do when we teach or learn women's studies, lies in the very formation of the field itself. And as the reader that she edits, the first probably women's studies reader, we see that it's impossible, like other readers, to have organized it into disciplines or themes, and that women's studies continues to be a field that is practiced in varying modes and on multiple sites. And I'm going to focus just on the site of the UGC-sponsored women's studies centers, and not because, not least because one is familiar with these or works in this kind of a space of women's studies, but largely because these centers bring to the fore the peculiar case of expansion of women's studies in higher education. And to sort of cut it short, I'll just present a few numbers to sort of explain what I mean by peculiar expansion of women's studies in higher education. Beginning with four centers in the eighth plan, we stand today at 130 in varying forms of temporariness of structure. But also consider the number, the first written history probably of institutionalization of women's studies, the narratives from the women's studies family. Out of the 17 narratives, 11 are about women's studies centers sponsored by the UGC. Contrast this with the reader I was just mentioning, edited by Mary John, a comprehensive mapping of the field. 84 entries, only 4 from the women's studies centers and 3 from the founding moment. So in a sense, probably at one point the statement that Uma Chakravarti had made, it had seemed provocative, that the most interesting work in women's studies seems to have been done outside of the formal centers. And for those of us located in the centers, I think we need to take this seriously, because for long, any discussion on UGC-sponsored centers, and understandably so, has just focused on the neglect by the UGC, neglect by the university. And in a sense, we have rarely looked at our relationship with the state or with the women's movement, except for a nostalgia for the founding mothers and how they moved more easily between the women's movement and women's studies, sometimes not stopping a little to understand that the women's movement itself has changed a lot since then. It is constituted by varying kinds of organizations which are in discord and dialogue with each other, and we might have to do a more detailed analysis across regions before we jump to conclusions about direct impact or influence of the two on each other, so to say. Lesser still, the so-called family of the women's studies centers has rarely ever looked at or collectively engaged with understanding or disruptive the cores of its dwelling, the practices and policy of higher education, so to say. And I'd like to therefore focus a little on that today, on how do we look at women's studies within the larger context of the policy of higher education in our present. Very quickly, we all know, those of us located in the centers, that the centers, consciously and unconsciously, all of us have come up with some formula that combines teaching, research, documentation, and extension, as it is called in the UGC guidelines. And in a sense, till the mid-90s, teaching was never such a huge issue. Curriculum and pedagogies did not come on the agenda for these centers. And if we look at the 1990s, we find this as a conjuncture, a decade in which feminist scholarship seems to have had a very rich engagement with the politics of caste, of sexuality, of region, of global economic integration, or repressive practices of the state. So in a sense, this is a decade in which the category gender was radicalized, and the subject of feminism in many ways, a singular subject, questioned. If you just look at what is happening in our centers, the UGC-sponsored centers in the same decade, we see that teaching programs mushroom, full-time BA, master's, research programs. And I'm looking here for, looking at 50 such curricula that mushroomed during this period, and looking just at their reading lists. And one sees that in 70% of the reading lists, you don't find even a mention of this feminist scholarship that I'm talking about. Even the remaining 30%, you see that 10% of these are really feminist scholarship drawn from the white North Atlantic feminist scholarship for feminist theory courses. So what I'm suggesting is really that there is not just a disjunct between the feminist political intellectual project and the institutionalization of women's studies in higher education. But going a little ahead, we also see that the radicalization of the category gender that we see the feminist intellectual project engaged in seems to be domesticated, seems to be stabilized on the site of this UGC-sponsored women's studies centers in many ways, and the curricula being the major sort of site on which we can see this. And on the other hand, we've seen a lot of focus in policies of higher education on gearing higher education to the knowledge economy. And in many ways, there have been debates and there have been differences within the different committees, within and across committees, on questions of privatization of higher education or questions of social justice and affirmative action. In a sense, at the local university level, and those of us who work there would definitely have more to share on this, this meant that local academic bodies began to talk overnight about the usability of the degree, and particularly in social sciences and humanities, and there were huge amount of pressures to quote-unquote vocationalize the courses, to make them professional, to make them usable. For many of us were asked to take a industry member on our board of studies, so usability of the degree became a very huge issue. And it was very clear how in a sense, all others in social sciences and humanities thought women's studies had an edge over them. And particularly, in a sense, we recognized that we were more vulnerable than others to this whole new drive for usable degrees, not just because we are a new program, but largely because of the omnipresence of, if we can call them, official international feminisms in this decade. Whether it is of the World Bank variety or whether it is of the UN variety, there was a sense created in academic bodies that women's studies degrees are more usable, more professional than other degrees. Though in a sense, as an intellectual community, we have not really responded to these new developments in higher education. An interesting moment in this decade is the way in which there were several status reports, both of social sciences and of women's studies. Interestingly, the former don't even refer to the latter. And I'm referring here to the ICSSR or the SSRC reports on the state of social sciences. And but there are similarities between the two reports. Both do not look at knowledges produced in Indian languages. Both mention some centers as centers of excellence, without ever telling us what might be the underlying models of excellence. And in the absence of this, we are left thinking that individual excellence is what makes these centers centers of excellence. The other two sort of very worrisome similarities in both these reports are that they are silent on two of the most important developments in higher education in the last decade, the changing social composition of students and the question of employability that the students are raising in different ways, not in the ways the usability of the degree is being really posed. And in a sense, therefore, what we've had only is responses from liberal academics who've been calling this a situation of crisis and have been expressing a nostalgia for a once pure university. In a sense, for those of us in women's studies, this might not, what is the crisis of the disciplines or for the disciplines might not be a crisis. Are we ready to look at this perceived crisis and cultural capital at the disposal of those who are calling the crisis and really try and see if this moment might be an opportunity for women's studies? And I mean opportunity in the sense, probably this might just be labeled as rational utopianism if you like, but I'm saying, can this moment be one in which through our pedagogical and curricular initiatives, we are not only thinking of renovating and reinventing women's studies in the university, but we are also trying to make a case by wedging open the post divide between the quality question and the equality question in higher education, really try and make a case for public investment in higher education in general and women's studies in particular. And in a sense, on a very, very modest level, and my time is running out, so I'll just take a minute if you allow me and close and maybe leave things. Very quickly, maybe on just one or two things. Taking off from saying that nothing seems to be happening, I'd like to sort of focus again on students and say that I wouldn't like to go with this and say nothing is happening either in the women's movement or women's studies or the relationship between the two. I think I'd like to go back to what I briefly raised, saying that the student composition of the classrooms has changed tremendously in the last 10 years and posing major challenges to what we teach and how we teach, and that is producing new knowledges. And often sometimes these new knowledges, I don't know if in a sense even women's studies in a way is becoming canonized and we are not ready to recognize these new knowledges, and would we open up to understanding these new knowledges that are being produced. And secondly, on the same lines, in a sense as teachers, we are not on firm grounds, and that's wonderful. I mean, earlier, 10 years back, we thought we were training students to have careers identical to us. They would either become researchers or they would become teachers just like us. And that has been so wonderfully challenged in the last 10 years, in a sense, making space for this whole teacher-student power relationship to be interrogated in new ways. And therefore, the classroom in many ways is a very exciting space right now. The question is, do we look at it as exciting or as nothing happening there?
The second module will introduce us to going beyond the classics, exploring difference in the US and in Europe. This module will start with the question, why is it that our understanding of what is called second wave feminism, or basically feminism that emerged in the 1960s and 70s, why is it so whitewashed? Why have we assumed that this feminism is really all about a set of classics, five or six classics written by white feminists in the 1960s and 70s. And we shall, to this purpose, try and explore what were the other feminisms, other voices in feminisms that emerged during this period. Try and see how the racial and ethnic and class status of women, the movements from which they came, and the structure of the relationship between the different movements of the period actually influence the kind of feminisms they articulated.